Good morning, everyone. I'd like to invite you to come in to the sanctuary as we begin to prepare for worship, and also a welcome to those of you who are joining us online. Welcome to Open Door Bible Church. Our annual business meeting, they call it a business meeting tonight at 6 p.m., but it's really a celebration of what the Lord is doing here at the Open Door Bible Church family. It's really a neat time of celebration. So that's tonight at 6 p.m. You guys have been so faithful in your attendance and coming in spite of the COVID and all that sort of stuff. We're going to award you next week by giving you an extra hour's sleep. Time change, that's something to celebrate too. Time change next Sunday. Remember, we fall back 1 hour, fall back. And then, of course, the Operation Christmas Child boxes are due November 15th. Please remember that. And we have boxes, empty boxes, for you to utilize there in the back of the sanctuary. Now let's begin to prepare for worship.
Thanks, Kathy. He is exalted. Let's stand and begin to worship the Lord together this morning. Let's begin with this great hymn, this great prayer, Come Thou Fount. Of course, this is the hymn where the second verse talks about raising an Ebenezer, a reminder of God's faithfulness and the ways that God has been with us in the past. So let's worship together this morning. All right, here we go.
From Psalm 47, "For God is King over all the earth." Sing praises with the psalm. God reigns over the nations. God sits on his holy throne. Lord God Jehovah, King of the universe, every day we will praise you and lift up your name forever and ever. You are great and most worthy of praise. One generation commends your works to another. Let them tell of your mighty acts. They speak of the glorious splendor of your majesty, and as we meditate on them, Lord, we are astounded. So work in our minds and our hearts this morning as we gather to worship you and celebrate your abundant goodness. We pray this in the name of our Savior Jesus and the power of your Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen. Go ahead and remain standing if you would. Let's continue singing, continue worshiping the Lord for his faithfulness this morning. And let's sing Forever, which most of the time we sing all together. Let's try something a little bit different. The song has a call and response built in. So let's just see what happens. Gentlemen, why don't we start? And ladies, if you would sing the response, "As Love Endures Forever," let's see how it goes. We'll give it a try, and we'll just see what happens. Let's give it a try.
Above all things,
together
sing praise.
Please be seated.
That is a reminder about the shoe boxes, and if you're doing that, that's wonderful. We're glad that you are. Remember that we want to make sure that we're sending something that's quality, so if it comes down to it, make one box rather than four, and put some stuff in there that the people in the third world would like. And I got news for you, soccer balls and pumps go a long ways. And in a lot of the countries of the world that these boxes get to, that is an amazing gift that you would be sending. Anyway, so if you'd like to take part in that, we'd sure love to have you. I'm going to do something special here in a minute. I have no idea how long Bob Dunbar served as treasurer, but it was way before I got here, so figure 20 years, maybe 30, I don't know. Anyway, Bob has trained up Don Greer, and Bob has stepped away from that role, and I have here just a statement of thanks from the church for you, Bob. First of all, we always thank God for you. As we pray to God our Father about you, and when we think of your faithful work, your loving deeds, and the enduring hope that you have because of our Lord Jesus. And then it may not have seemed like a big deal to you, but your faithful service to God and his people has been a wonderful gift to us all. Thank you. Kind of like goodbyes. I hate goodbyes too. So now, Bob's not going anywhere, but he is stepping down from that responsibility. Let's go ahead and look at our missions focus here. Nathan and Vera Beck working in the Czech Republic. And if you don't get their information, please, if you'd like to get that, we'd love to get you on their list. They've got amazing stories to tell of the work that God is doing. And they are people who are getting people into the Word of God, and God's Word is changing lives, and that's one of the reasons that it's exciting to hear from them and to hear what's going on in the Czech Republic. And they've asked us to pray especially for wisdom and for good health for them as they seek to continue to reach out and start more of these groups that study the Bible and get people into the Word of God. And it's amazing how God changes their hearts. And then the next one is Michael and Lindy and the kids, and they sent out a praise that we've been praying. We prayed for a long time for the airstrip that they had their hangar on. They got that back, but then they were coming up against some deadlines again. They have been granted a six-month extension, so they have six more months. But they're looking to get a 15-year lease, not a lease, but a permission from the government. So please pray for that. That's a huge thing. It makes them able to fly right into the place where their hangar is. Otherwise, they're flying into the international airport, parking on the tarmac, and then driving all the way back and loading and unloading in the sight of everybody, which is kind of something they were nervous about most of the time. So keep praying for them. Pray for safety for Michael and the pilots as they minister in some very hazardous places when it comes to taking airplanes off the ground and putting them back down on the ground. And Michael is coming up on his annual physical, which is a really stringent thing when you are a pilot. So pray for him as he goes through all of that stuff. Several of their family had COVID. They all are over that, and we can praise God for that as well. Dan and Florina did make it home for her mother's funeral. That all happened this week, and they'll be heading back to Mexico. So pray for them and all of that travel. And again, we've got Bill Butler and Cammy Crank and Jerry Albert and Shirley Bachelman, Daryl Morris, people that we continue to pray for. There are things going on with all of them that need us to continue to uphold them in prayer. Sometimes you look at some things, oh yeah, I've been praying that for a while. That's okay, they still need it. So keep praying, if you would. That'd be really great. Let's spend some time praying right now. Lord, we thank you so much that we can come to you. We thank you for your amazing grace and your goodness to us. We are thankful that when we think about all that we have, if it comes down to all I have is you, what an amazing and wondrous thing that is, and that we have you. And so we thank you for that. And we just lift up to you the Becks and the Busenitz, and Lord, the things that we just mentioned, We pray that you would continue to work in their hearts and in their lives. And we pray especially for Michael's physical and all the stuff with him so that he can get back on track of the flying that he does and overseeing all the other pilots as well. Pray for their safety and all the things that they do. Lord, we do lift up those who are struggling and hurting physically in our church. We've mentioned some already by name. We ask that you would lay your hand on them, help them to know your presence in those difficult times when they may feel alone or when they feel just not very well. Lord, lay your hand on them, encourage and strengthen them, I ask. We thank you, Lord, for the opportunity that we have here in this church family to worship you and to come to you with praise and adoration. And Lord, we lift you up this morning in worship, and in your name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Let's stand one more time together and sing this hymn as a preparation to look into God's word. As we sing, of course, kids through fifth grade can head downstairs to Children's Church if your family would like to take advantage of Children's Church. And if not, that's completely fine as well. Let's sing about God's grace together this morning.
Marvelous grace of our loving Lord, grace that exceeds our sin and our guilt. Yonder on Calvary's mount outpoured, there where the blood of the Lamb was spilled. Grace, grace, God's grace. Grace that will pardon and cleanse within. Grace, grace, God's grace. Grace that is greater than all our sin. Sin and despair like the sea waves cold threaten the soul within. Grace that is greater, yes, grace untold, points to the refuge of mighty cross. Grace, grace, God's grace, grace that will pardon and cleanse within. Grace, grace, God's grace. That is greater than all our sin.
Let's sing one more verse.
Dark is the stain that we cannot hide. What can avail to wash it away? Look, there is flowing a crimson tide, whiter than snow you may be. That will pardon and cleanse within. Grace, grace, God's grace. Grace that is greater than all our sin.
Would you read with me, please, a selection of scripture from Daniel chapter 4, reading together. That same hour the judgment was fulfilled, and Nebuchadnezzar was driven from human society. He ate grass like a cow, and he was drenched with the dew of heaven. After this time had passed, I, Nebuchadnezzar, looked up to heaven. My sanity returned, and I praised and worshiped the Most High and honored the One who lives forever. His rule is everlasting, and his kingdom is eternal. All the people of earth are nothing compared to him. He does as he pleases among the angels of heaven and among the people of earth. No one can stop him or say to him, "What do you mean by doing these things?" When my saint returned to me, so did my honor and glory and kingdom. My advisors and nobles sought me out, and I was restored as head of my kingdom with even greater honor than before. Now I, Nebuchadnezzar, praise and glorify and honor the King of Heaven. All his acts are just and true, and he is able to humble the proud.
We are going to be studying Daniel 4 this morning. Let's pray. Lord, thank you so much for the opportunity that we have to gather, to worship, to sing, to lift our hearts and voices and our thoughts in praise and worship. Thank you for that privilege. And now, Lord, as we look into your word, we ask for your guidance and your help. We ask that you would help us to see the truth that you put here for us. And Lord, help us to be able to apply it and live out the truth that's here in our own lives. We ask this in your name. Amen. Please be seated. Carol, I want to thank you for your prayers as we were gone for the last 2 weeks. When we left for vacation, we did not know we were going to be spending several days in the Detroit area with a family funeral. And yet it was, in one sense, a really good thing for us. We didn't have to turn around from here to make a 16-hour trip to that funeral. We were already right 2-3 hours away. So it was good to be able to be with family during that time of loss and mourning. And then also just to have some time, some downtime as well. So thank you for your prayers during that time. I thought it would be interesting for the next 2 weeks, before the election comes and goes, and thankfully maybe at that point things will calm down a little bit. That's my prayer anyway. I just thought it would be interesting for us to think through some things from the perspective of what does God think about rulers and authorities? And Daniel 4 is one of those chapters that talks about that. So we're going to be there this week, and the next week we'll be doing it a little bit more having to do with the sovereignty of God. But I came across this illustration this week, and it really struck me. They were comparing King Nebuchadnezzar with Nicolae Ceaușescu, who was the ruler of Romania, a communist Romania. And both of these men are ruthless. I mean, they were powerful men, and both of them exalted themselves in incredible ways. Both of them were godless in the sense of the God of the Bible. Nebuchadnezzar probably believed in a bunch of gods. Ceaușescu, none at all. And so you've got these things going on. And you see the contrast of the two. You know, on one hand, Nebuchadnezzar's putting up statues and telling people to worship him. And if you don't do that, well, then you're going to get thrown in the furnace. On the other hand, you got a man of Ceaușescu who tortured and destroyed. He destroyed churches, tortured Christians, and tried to basically stomp out anything Christian in the whole country. At one point, he decided that he wanted the national opera to write a song that would honor him. And the song was supposed to say this: Ceaușescu is good, righteous, and holy. And that was the directives that he gave the person who was in charge of the opera. And he wanted it to be ready for his 72nd birthday, which would have been January 26, 1990. Okay, that's what he wanted it done. However, on December 25th, 1989, he was deposed and he was executed. And there were people who, at that point in time, who said the reason God took him down and just got rid of him completely was because he tried to lift himself up to be God. I can't argue with that. If you think that that's who you are and you want this whole your whole nation singing about how amazing you are and righteous you are, you think you're up there somewhere. Nebuchadnezzar was the same way. Now, as we look at the book of Daniel, we see the sovereignty of God starts in chapter 1 and runs all the way through. And I wish we could do all of those chapters, but we're going to just concentrate on 4. But just so that you get a feel for the flow of it, in Daniel chapter 1, God, by his sovereign choice, gave Jerusalem over. They had been disobeying him. They had been living in sin for many years. They had many prophets come and warn them, and they didn't listen. So it says in Daniel that Nebuchadnezzar came, but God delivered the city over to him. It was God's work. And of course, that's when Daniel and some of the others are taken back to Babylon. So God's sovereign in all of that. This was his choice that this happened, that Jerusalem would suffer the consequences of their sin. Daniel 2, you've got that whole thing where Nebuchadnezzar has the dream. And remember, he asked the wise men, come and tell me my dream, and then I'll understand that you can actually tell me what it means. The way it used to be was that, you know, you would tell them the dream, and then they'd make something up and tell you, okay, what it meant. But he didn't want that. He said, you tell me what my dream was, and then I'll know. Well, this was the dream. It was going to be, there was a man, a statue that the head was gold and the chest and arms were silver. The next part was bronze, and then there was iron, and then iron mixed with clay, all in that statue. And then a stone came rolling down and hit the statue, and that stone then filled all of the land. That's chapter 2. And again, God is showing his sovereign plan in chapter 2 for the nations that were going to come. Okay, you had Babylon, and then you have the Medes and Persians, and then right on down, all of the different empires are pictured in that statue. So God was showing his sovereign plan for the nations. Chapter 3. Now, we don't know if the statue was the same, and we don't know if that statue which he saw, that he was the head of gold, made him think, well, you know what? I'm just going to stay in power, and I'm going to make a whole statue of gold, and everybody's going to bow down to it because it'll be a statue that says, I'm a god. And so sure enough, remember Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego are supposed to do it. They don't. And God, by his sovereign will, is with them in the fire and spares them. That's an amazing thing as you think about God working through all of that. And then in chapter 4, you've got the sovereignty of God. Shows this dream to him, and we'll talk about the dream in a minute. You know, you are like this big tree, and you fill the land, and all good things come from you, and then cut the tree down, and then, guess what? You get to eat grass for a while. And sure enough, it happened. Now, stop and think, just for a second, don't tell anybody, but stop and think about the most embarrassing thing you've ever had happen to you or that you've done or said. Okay? Now, would you like to come up here and tell the world about it? No. Well, there's some things that I'm so embarrassed about, I don't even want Carol to know. And so, you know, there's things that you don't want to share those things. Nebuchadnezzar, for some reason, decided that this horribly embarrassing thing that happens to him needs to be broadcast so that everybody can learn from what has happened to him. And that's what Daniel chapter 4 is all about. So here you've got King Nebuchadnezzar full of pride and arrogance, and yet he goes through this humbling experience. Let's jump in and see what he has to say. Verse 1, chapter 4, King Nebuchadnezzar, to all the peoples, nations, men of every language who lived in the world, may you prosper greatly. It is my pleasure to tell you about the miraculous signs and wonders that the Most High God has performed for me. How great are his signs, how mighty his wonders. His kingdom is the eternal kingdom. His dominion endures from generation to generation. So the minute you read this, you begin to say, okay, something has changed. Something's different with this guy. In the previous chapter, he's saying, you need to bow down to the statue, and you need to worship my statue, which I created. And now he's saying, the Most High God. There is a Most High God, and that Most High God has performed incredible things in me. And by the way, that's a very special phrase that he uses, the Most High God. Comes first time to us in Daniel 3, where Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego talk about the Most High God and how he can protect them. And now Nebuchadnezzar is talking about the Most High God. And he goes on to tell the story. Then he says in verse 4, I was at my home in my palace, contented and prosperous, and I had a dream that made me afraid. So here he is. He's living all the stuff that he's ever wanted to live. He's conquered everything he wants to conquer. He's wealthy beyond all things. He's created an incredible city. It's an oasis in the desert. It's huge. It's got hanging gardens, one of the wonders of seven wonders of the ancient world. And he was the designer and the architect of all of that. Not to mention, in fact, he was a brilliant military strategist. And so he has this dream, and it scares him to death. And he calls all the wise men or the magicians, and they can't tell him anything. And then finally he calls Daniel, who's the chief of all the magicians or wise men or the king's counselors. And Nebuchadnezzar tells him the dream. There's this huge tree, and it's got fruit, and all the animals and birds gather under it, and this tree is so big that it fills the land, and everybody receives sustenance from this tree. And then he says a holy messenger or a watchman calls out, and they cut down the tree and trim off the branches and bind the stump with iron. And then it also says in verse 18, let 7 times or 7 years go by until he admits the Most High is sovereign over who is king. And so all that takes place in verses 6 through 18. Now, again, think about who this is. This is Nebuchadnezzar. He's the most powerful man in the world at that point in time. And yet, at this point in time now, he's wondering what's coming. What is happening? Why is all this going on? And so he told Daniel the dream. And verse 19 tells you something about Daniel. Look at how he responds. Then Daniel, also called Belteshazzar, was greatly perplexed for a time, and his thoughts terrified him. It gives you a sense of what Daniel must have been like and what he thought about Nebuchadnezzar. He began to realize, I know what this dream's all about. He understood that. God made it clear to him already. And as he heard this dream, he didn't want to tell the king. He didn't want him to know. He felt some kind of obligation for the king, and he felt close to the king in some way. He'd served him for many years. And then he says in verse, at the end of verse 19, may the dream apply to your enemies. I don't want this to be for you. And then in verse 19 and 21, he repeats the dream. And then verse 22, this is the kind of the part that hits hard. You, O king, are that tree. Okay, so this amazingly gorgeous and amazing tree that everybody gets sustenance out of this tree. And he is trying to let him see, this is amazing. And yet, you're the tree, and you know what happened to that tree. You saw it in your dream. The tree's coming down. And then verse 24, he says, this is the interpretation, O king. The decree of the Most High has issued against my lord, the king. This is a declaration of a judgment. You will be driven from people and will live with wild animals. You will eat grass like cattle and be drenched with dew of heaven. 7 times will pass for you until you acknowledge that the Most High is sovereign over the kingdoms of men, and he gives them to anyone he wishes. That's a powerful statement that Daniel's making. He's saying, you need to know, king, God is the one who's saying this. God is the one who wants you to hear this. And this is what's going to happen to you. You are going to be driven away from humanity, from human society. You're going to live with wild animals. Not only that, you're going to eat grass like a cow. And not only that, you're going to be out there at the mercy of the elements. You're going to be drenched by the rains, and you're going to be parched by the sun. And this is going to be for 7 years. And the reason for it, O king, is that you need to understand that the Most High God is sovereign over all of the kingdoms of the world. And he wants you to understand that. And for you to know that you only have power because he has given it to you. And then he goes on to say, hey, the fact that the stump is still there, that means there's hope. That means that you will come back and you'll have a chance to reign again. But you have to understand, you have to acknowledge that God is sovereign. And so in verse 27, he says, listen, take my advice. Repent of your wrongdoing. Turn away from that. And perhaps God will not do this to you. And we move on to verse 28, where there's a description. It says, all of this happened to King Nebuchadnezzar, you know, and there's the, you know, time goes by, and maybe Nebuchadnezzar went to bed the first night wondering if it was going to happen the next day, and maybe he was full of fear for a period of time, but eventually a year goes by, 12 months, And he's walking along, it says in verse 29, on the upper part of his palace and looking out on this amazing city that he has designed and had built. And he says, isn't this the great Babylon I have built as a royal residence by my mighty power and the glory of my majesty? So he didn't learn anything, did he? It's me, it's my, I did all this. I'm the powerful one here. Verse 31, the words were still on his lips when a voice came from heaven. This is what is decreed for you, Nebuchadnezzar. Your royal authority has been taken from you. It's gone. You are no longer king of Babylon. Verse 33 says, immediately what had been said about Nebuchadnezzar was fulfilled. Now, I'm going to read, this is someone's artistic version, perhaps, or just kind of a narration of what might have happened. And it's a great description of what this might have looked like. In the twinkling of an eye, Nebuchadnezzar became a raving maniac. With wild shrieks, he rushed from the room and down the staircase as the crown of gold toppled from his head. Tearing from his body his royal robes and scattering them as he went through the doors and down the corridors, he ran, bellowing like a wounded bull, while the palace servants looked on in horror. By the time he made it out the gate, the great door of the palace, he had very little clothing left. As he continued his mad flight down the main street, Nebuchadnezzar, the proud and dignified king of the greatest empire of ancient times, was running down the streets of his capital city, stark naked. It's very possible it was something very much like that. This actually is a mental disorder, and it's cataloged, and there are some rare cases where this has been followed, and they found it. And the biggest thing that happens is they think they're cows. They really do. And they eat grass. And so, in one fell swoop, Nebuchadnezzar goes from being the most powerful to being absolutely out of his mind and not knowing anything that's going on. Verse 33 describes 7 years. And basically it says, immediately all that was said was fulfilled. He was driven away. He ate grass like cattle. His body was drenched with the dew of heaven, and until his hair grew really long and his nails were really long. In Daniel chapter 5, Daniel's telling Belshazzar about Nebuchadnezzar, and he says this in verse 21, speaking of Nebuchadnezzar, he was driven away from people and given the mind of an animal. He lived with the wild donkeys and ate grass like cattle. And so there you have the whole thing is being described, and this is what happened, and all of that took place. And then you come to the coming back part of it, coming back to see what happens. And this is the part we read earlier. You know, at the end of the 7 years, verse 34, Nebuchadnezzar raised his eyes toward heaven, and my sanity was restored, and then I praised the Most High God. I honored and glorified him who lives forever. And then he continues to talk about his God's eternal dominion, God's kingdom. He's the one who's in control of all things from generation to generation. Verse 35, all the peoples of the earth are regarded as nothing. He does as he pleases with the powers of heaven and the people of earth. No one can hold back his hand or say to him, what have you done? And so Nebuchadnezzar's has gotten through his head finally, God is the sovereign one, not me, not Nebuchadnezzar. And it's interesting, the words that he used, he says, I praise the Most High, I honored and glorified him. Those two words in the tense that they're written indicate a continuing, ongoing action on his part. So it wasn't just that he wrote this and he says, well, I praise God. This is something that, as it's being written, and is also being played out in his life, and he is continuously, ongoing, honoring and glorifying God. That's the one thing he wants to do. And the kind of thought that runs through those words is the ideas of respect and reverence and admiration and worship. So here are the steps to his restoration, if you want to just kind of look at those very quickly. He looked up to heaven. And this is the recognition that God is the highest authority. He's the Most High. Second thing, his sanity was restored. So he looked up, and at that point, his sanity was restored. Just as quickly as it was taken away, it was restored. That's the power of God. And then he says he praised the Most High. He recognized that there is nobody higher than God. On another level, he understood that God doesn't answer to anybody, but that he, Nebuchadnezzar, has to answer to God. And then he honored and glorified God, and he kept on doing that. That was an ongoing thing for him. Verse 36 says, at the same time that my sanity was restored, guess what? They came back. They found me. They said, hey, we want you to come back and run the kingdom again. And sure enough, he goes back and begins to run the kingdom. So the result of being restored in verse 37, now I, Nebuchadnezzar, praise and exalt and glorify the King of Heaven because everything he does is right. Yeah, he turned me into a cow for 7 years. It was the right thing to do. Yeah, he took away all my power. It was the right thing to do. And so Nebuchadnezzar, everything he does is right and his ways are just. And those who walk in pride, Nebuchadnezzar saying, me, like me, he is able to humble. He's able to humble. And that's the high point of the whole fourth chapter. You get to that point and you realize, almost like a doxologist, he's praising God and for the amazing things that God has done. Now we're going to look at some implications as we continue on. The first application or implication is that in verse 17, 25, 26, and 32, it all says that this is going to happen to Nebuchadnezzar for one reason, so that he would acknowledge that the Most High God is sovereign. That's what Nebuchadnezzar was supposed to learn. You need to understand, Nebuchadnezzar, you're powerful and you're in control of all these things and you have the power of life and death, but guess what? God has power over you. God has power over you. Now, if you want to define sovereignty, there's all kinds of ways of defining that, but just a kind of a brief definition. Sovereign, the whole idea of being supreme in authority and power, to be self-governed, not ruled by anyone else, not answerable to anybody. That's what God is. And Nebuchadnezzar thought he was that and learned, I answer to God. I answer to God. Perhaps there's a lesson for us there as well. Maybe we need to remember on a practical level, not just in our heads, but on a practical everyday level, do I really believe God's in control? Do I really trust him? Those are some questions that we need to kind of think through. And we're heading into some, well, we've been going through some difficult stuff this year. And now we're heading into an election. Do we believe God is sovereign or don't we? Do we believe that he's in control of all things or don't we? God is sovereign and he is in control and he puts rulers where he wants them, including rulers that are wicked because they have a purpose. And I don't understand all the ways that God does that, but I do now am able to look back on some of those things and say, okay, God, I get it. I understand now what it is that you were trying to do in that setting. Romans 13, we studied this at the end of last year. I'm just going to read a couple of the verses and then move on from that. But everyone must submit himself to the governing authorities, Romans 13, 1. For there is no authority except that which God has established. Nebuchadnezzar would have said, yep, that's absolutely right. The authorities that exist have been established by God. And again, you sit there and you think about Paul. You're writing to people in Rome, and the people in Rome have seen the worst of some of the Caesars and some of the people who are in charge of the Roman Empire. And yet Paul says, you need to know God uses people and puts them in places for his own purposes. He goes on in 2 through 4 and talks about how if you rebel against the authority which God has established, then you're rebelling against God himself. Verse 5, he goes on and says, therefore it is necessary to submit to the authorities, not only because of possible punishment, but also because of conscience. And Tim, I jumped to the third slide there. Sorry about that. Thank you. So he says, it's necessary to submit to the authorities, not only because of possible punishment, but because of conscience. And the reason saying that is God is the one who has done this. Now, Paul's writing to people in the Church of Rome. Is there ever a time that Paul would say to them, now there are situations where God comes first and Caesar comes second? He's here, he's basically laying down, you know, people are in power because God has them there for a reason, and you're to submit to their authority. But there are times, and the church in Rome went through it, the church in Jerusalem went through it, where you have to say, I will obey unless you're asking me to do something that God has said I should not do. Remember when the disciples were called in before the Sanhedrin and they were told, we told you not to preach about Jesus, and you filled the city with this preaching and teaching of yours. Now you need to stop. You need to quit. And they said, you go figure it out, but we need to obey God rather than man. In Acts 5:29, we must obey God rather than men. Now, let me give a couple of examples here just to kind of help us think through some of these things. Depending on who happens to be in power, China has gone through a number of cycles, some that were somewhat friendly to Christians and others not so much. Right now, they're in the not so much part of things. And they're being told they can't meet together. They're being told they can't evangelize. They're being told they can't read the Bible. In the places where they might have a facility where they might have been meeting in, all of the verses and things were taken down and sayings of Mao have been put up. God used Nebuchadnezzar, who was ruthless and wicked, to discipline his chosen people and the nation of Israel. So Daniel is able to say, obey God, and submit to the authorities and those things that you can. And on one level, that's exactly what the people, the believers in China, have had to do. Whenever possible, fine, we do what the government tells us to do. But if the government tells us that we can no longer read our Bibles and we can no longer preach the gospel and we can no longer meet together, then that's something that we say we must obey God rather than men. Now, again, the sovereignty of God, we see it in different ways. If you've done any reading about Mao Zedong and the whole revolution that he brought into China, you understand that when he came in, there were millions and millions of people who were slaughtered. Some of it were just the people who were the university professors and doctors and lawyers, but also thousands, hundreds of thousands of Christians were just slaughtered. And so he comes in, and he comes in with this horrendously awful things that he does in his nation. And yet, even though he's doing all of these hideous things and evil things that hurt many, many people, one thing he did, before him, China had a number of different dialects of Chinese. I've been told that as many as 100 different dialects, many of them seriously different from the others, existed. So missionaries that were there before were all over the place trying to translate the scriptures into all of these dialects. Mao Zedong came in and said, no more. We will not have any other dialect but this one version of Chinese. We will all speak it. It will be what we learn. It will be what we teach our children. And so in one fell swoop, an evil dictator came in and made it a whole lot easier for the Bible to be translated into one language with billions of Chinese would be able to read. And the Bible started going into China in numbers that were incredible because of the fact that it was one unified language. Now, I'm not honoring or respecting that man at all, but I'm saying God sovereignly used this man to have Chinese be the same everywhere so that that Bible could be brought in, and they're still taking Bibles in all of the time, and people are being saved, and the church in China is still one of the fastest growing in the world. And we have an election coming up, and as citizens of this nation, we have the right to vote. And I believe that the best thing we can do is to be informed, learn, study the things, and then we are to vote our conscience. That's what God has asked us to do. I would never dream of standing up here and telling you, this is the person or this is the person. I'm not going to do that. But I'm going to encourage you to go ahead and vote. That's part of what we do. As believers, as citizens of this country, we get informed, we learn the details of what we need to learn, and then we go and we do cast our ballot, knowing that God is ruling and overruling. He will use us, and he will use our votes. But one of the things we can always remember, God's in control. A number of years ago, the person I voted for didn't get in. And I remember going into a bit of a depression thinking, boy, what are you doing, God? You know what? God knew what he was doing. One of the things God doesn't have to do is ask me my opinion. I share it many times with him, but he doesn't ask for it, just so that you know, okay? And I just want to say that we are called on, as believers, to be good citizens. So pray, think about it, study it, and then exercise your conscience in casting your vote. There's a second application here when we think about God's sovereignty. The biggest thing that stood between Nebuchadnezzar and God was his arrogance and his pride. He really did think he was the most important sovereign anywhere, and that nobody else mattered as much as he did. And hey, he was powerful. He was brilliant. He did incredible things. He was recognized for the amazing things that he had done. But he was ruthless and vicious and had no problem just slaughtering people if that's what he felt he needed to do. And so his pride and his arrogance kept him thinking that he really was the most important thing. Now, there's a difference when we think about pride, and I want to just kind of lay some things out here quickly. There's a difference between arrogant, sinful pride and pride or satisfaction in doing a good job in something. Okay, so if I'm out there and I'm mowing my lawn and I'm mowing along and I really want to make it look nice and I do my best job and it's done and I go, wow, that's awesome. I'm glad that's done. It looks good. There's nothing wrong with that sentiment. But if I'm out there thinking, you know what, that idiot neighbor of mine, he's going to see something special when I finish this. And by the way, I wish he'd, and you know, I'm starting to think through all the, what am I doing? I'm comparing myself and I'm lifting myself up. That crosses the line. That's not satisfaction in a job well done anymore. Our daughters have grown up hearing us say to them, we're proud of you. That's a good thing. What they have not heard us say is, you are so much better than that person. Or you deserve this and you didn't get it, but it's because they cheated. They don't hear those kinds of things. They never heard those from us. No matter what they did, no matter how well it turned out, it was always, sweetie, you did a great job. You did your best. We are proud of you. That's the difference, I think, when you start looking at it. When you start comparing and start lifting one up and putting another one down, then you're slipping into that sinful pride and arrogance. I just want to share some of these thoughts here. Arrogant, proud people, what do they look like? And maybe you find yourself in some of these categories. I've certainly been in some of them. Sinful pride is a critical attitude, and nobody else is good enough. It's an attitude that focuses on the faults of others. I'm always looking for the flaws. That's the kind of thought that's there. It's very self-protective of one's own reputation. And driven to seek the spotlight and the affirmation and the recognition. Cannot rejoice. Sinful pride cannot rejoice when others are recognized and when they are acknowledged. Sinful pride has a hard time saying, I was wrong. Will you forgive me? Sinful pride is something that expects others to move in the reconciliation process, that they would do all of that and then you would just kind of receive it at the end. Sinful pride is the whole idea of constantly comparing and putting others down and ourselves up. God hated Nebuchadnezzar's pride and his arrogance. And by the way, God hates pride and arrogance in my life and in yours and in our church. Arrogant pride comes between us and God, and it can destroy our close, intimate walk with him. God wants to touch and work deeply in our heart, but in pride, sometimes we harden our hearts and don't want to have anything to do with it. God may want me to be freed from the hurt and the pain and the failures of my past, but maybe I don't want to look at them the way God does, and so I don't join into that and don't get the freedom that he wants to give me. And God wants to encourage me to lift up and wants me to go to his word to be corrected and to understand his word, and yet sometimes in pride, I don't want to do that. I want to do what I want to do. God wants to help me with my struggles, and yet sometimes I'm the kind of person that says, you know what? I'm okay. I'm doing fine. I'm not, but, you know. God wants to make me strong in him. In my pride, I don't want to admit my weakness. I don't know if you fit into any of those. What does the Bible say? James 4:6. He gives us more grace. That is why the scripture says God opposes the proud, but gives grace to the humble. And by the way, God opposes means God is against. He's against the proud. Just a couple of ways of looking at this. Pride is refusing to admit when we are wrong and not asking forgiveness. Pride is refusing to accept help from anybody else. I can handle it. Don't need it. I'm good. Pride is refusing to pray or study and seek after God because maybe we wouldn't like the answer. Pride refuses to be thankful for all that God has done. Pride is refusing to turn to God for help. And that's, anytime we don't ask God for help, that is arrogance of the highest order. Dealing with pride and arrogance, this is, I think, something that I've had to continue to look through and learn and work at. First is look at what's going on and name it what it is. It's pride and it's sin. Second thing, confess that to God. And be specific, Lord God, as I was responding to that person or as I was thinking about that situation, I understand that my pride was kicking in there, and I confess that. And then we ask God to help. And why do we ask God for help? Because God opposes the proud, but gives grace to the humble. It's interesting, he doesn't give grace to the proud, does he? He gives grace to the humble. What do we take away from all this? Nebuchadnezzar refused to humble himself, so God did it for him. Very unique situation that God put him in, but it did the trick. Humility is not something we have until humbling ourselves is something we do. Think that through for a minute. Humility is not something we have until actually humbling ourselves is something that we are involved in doing. So you have to do it. You have to be humble and work towards being humble and seeing yourself through God's eyes and seeing yourself honestly with all the things that you've done wrong. And as you begin to see yourself humbly, well, then you begin to develop that attitude of humility. Now, just a couple of things quickly. Moving away from pride, this is how we can do that. I think there's just some thoughts and some verses. First of all, we need to treat pride as an enemy who wants to destroy us. Proverbs 13 says, pride leads to arguments. Have you ever had a relationship go really badly? And afterwards, when it all kind of came down to it, you realize that it was your pride that got in the way? Proverbs 8:13 says, all who fear the Lord will hate evil. That is why I hate pride and arrogance, corruption, and perverted speech. Those who reverence and honor God, what is it that they hate? They hate evil, and they hate pride, and they hate arrogance, and they hate corruption and perverted speech. But it's interesting. I hate evil, and the first thing he says is pride. Proverbs 11:2. When pride comes, then comes dishonor, and with the humble is wisdom. Pride leads to dishonor. And we could go through the book of Proverbs and just all kinds of verses. Psalms as well. But we need to treat pride as an enemy of our souls. And then the second part to that, welcome humility as a friend. Welcome humility as a friend. Peter, 1 Peter 5 puts it this way, young men, in the same way, be submissive to those who are older. And then he says, all of you, clothe yourselves with humility towards one another. Because God opposes the proud, but gives grace to the humble. I love that. Isn't that awesome? God opposes the proud, but he gives all of the grace that you possibly could need if you are coming humbly before him. So either you're going to be opposed by the God of the universe for being proud and arrogant, or you are going to receive all of the help and strength and encouragement that you could have if you come in humility to God. And then he goes on to say in verse 6 and 7, humble yourselves, therefore, under God's mighty hand, that he may lift you up in due time. Cast all of your anxiety on him, because he cares for you. And I've always thought about this in the sense that one of the ways that I humble myself before God is to cast my cares on him. Because when I don't cast my cares on him, what am I saying? Well, I can handle it. I can take care of it. God, you can help the others. But, you know, no. Whatever it is that's troubling me, struggling with, okay, God, here, I can't carry this. I need help. And he is the sovereign God of the universe who can be trusted. He gives grace to the humble. And when we cast our anxieties on him, we know that he is able to handle that. Isaiah 57:15, really great passage. For this is what the high and lofty one says, he who lives forever, whose name is holy. I live in a high and a holy place. That's God, high, holy, exalted, but also with him who is contrite and lowly in spirit. To revive the spirit of the lowly and to revive the heart of the contrite. Think of the contrast there. You've got the almighty, powerful, sovereign God of the universe. Everything is under his control. And he says, I dwell in this amazing, wondrous place, but also with you if you have a humble heart. If you have a heart that sees me as God and sees the need that you have for me, that's where I can really work. God opposes the proud, gives grace to those who are humble. So as we think through all of the issues of God's sovereignty in relationship to what's happening to us individually and our nation, just keep taking it back to God. And just keep trusting him because he knows what he's doing. Let's pray. Lord, thank you for your grace and thank you for your mercy. Thank you for your love and how you have been so amazingly working in our hearts. And even, Lord, when we don't want you to work, you're still there doing and still calling us and longing for us to come and just humbly say, okay, God, do what you need to do. So, Lord, in my heart, would you work this week? And in the hearts of my brothers and sisters, would you cause each of us to remember that that you're sovereign, and that you want us to be thinking of you in terms of ruling us and our hearts and our lives. And so help us with that whole area of surrendering and submission, which we just need to do on a daily basis. Please help us, Lord God. We ask in your name. Amen. We're going to transition.